Glory to the King. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you,
God.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Yeah, I was telling Paula I kind of overslept and took me a nap, and I said, I have been awake long. Okay, we should be going live. Yeah, set up. We're to go to all the our pages, even
Amen.
Kingdom Connection. Amen.
Hallelujah.
So let me be sure. And I definitely got to make sure is, I just got a message about the medicine too. Gotta make sure
you said it will go to my page. Sure. I don't see
it. It's got to go on HOD for sure. Because this is their day. Amen. Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. And we're on HOD. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Good afternoon, everybody on Facebook, and welcome to this Thursday instead of 1 hour with God. I'm doing a thankful Thursday because next Thursday is Thanksgiving. I will not be home because I will not be at home. But so I've got a special guest with me, and of course, Ursa, my dear sister. And let me share you something. She's got a new page called Kingdom Connection. So y'all follow her, like her page. But I'm going to read this song, and then we're going to open up in the word of prayer, and then we're going to let my guest, Paula Weems, she's been on my podcast before. It's just been a while back. But I'm going to let her share what she's thankful for. And we'll let the Holy Ghost take over where we don't never know what happens from time to time. So Psalms 100, I was looking up a good scripture for Thanksgiving. And this is the main one. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. All ye lands, serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. Yes, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. But Father God, I come before you right now, and I ask you to have your way in this broadcast. I know I said a plan for it, but it's your broadcast. So we allow you to come in and take over. Put the words in our speaker's mouth that you want her to speak to the people, the church, so that they may be encouraged and that their faith may be extended and lifted up, because sometimes we go through some stuff to help others. And I know my sister Paula has been through some stuff. We all have been through some stuff. But Father God, I pray whatever she speaks will encourage the next one. Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen. So, Sister Paula, tell them a little bit about what you do in the ministry, and then, you know, be led by the Spirit. Which story you want to share about why you're thankful?
Well, praise God. Amen. First, I want to honor God. Can you hear me okay? I just want to make sure that my volume's.
Yeah. Yes, and I'm going to mute my mic for a while.
I just want to thank God, number one. He is so amazing. You know, we need to be thankful for God in all things, for all things that, you know, the ministry that he has given me is to encourage, edify, exhort women, especially. I have and children, and sometimes I even just out in the kingdom, just everyday life, you know, encourage children. And I am so thankful. The Lord asked, I just got, was asking, you know, a scripture to share, and one of them was Psalms 107 and 1 and a few more. But this is first. Oh God, give thanks unto the Lord. for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. His mercy endures forever. His mercy is new every morning. God called me when I was 28 years old. It was prophesied over me that I was going to have a women's ministry, that I was going called to minister to his women. And I had just got born again, and I was like, how am I going to minister to women? I've been through so much. God can't use me. How can he use me? I'm so this, I'm so that, you know. And it hasn't come to pass until a couple of years ago. I seen what he wanted me to do. And I'm involved with a few ministries that I have given words, messages. God's given me messages. So on a couple of prayer lines, giving messages and praying for people. I have had tea time. That is a ministry that God gave me to come on and just have others come on and share. It's kind of like what it's called, tea time, just sitting, having a cup of tea with somebody, like your best friend, just sitting there talking about Jesus, sharing about Jesus, sharing about times in our lives, things that we've been through and things that God has brought us through. And so I will give you a little bit about my testimony. I apologize with my voice. I just got over the flu. So that voice and the cough is still trying to hang on, but Jesus is our healer. I am healed. So I rebuke any coughing during this message today. So I had been praying, well, God, what can I do for the kingdom? What can I do for your women? How am I going to, you know, do? And I have gone through so much. And I had done a women's conference here in Kansas about 5 years. It was 5 years ago in September. And the minister that came to help me said that, you know, you don't need to be praying for people and that, for women and that, because you're just still too broken. And I quit. I completely quit. I would not even speak to other women. I wouldn't encourage anyone. I kind of just went into a shell, so to speak. And a couple of years ago, God really put it on my heart that he was calling me. He had called me, and his callings are without repentance. That even, you know, sometimes when you're going through things, you can still minister. You know, we can all go through things. Just because we become born again doesn't mean that we are completely healed immediately of everything. Sometimes it's a process. There are times that we are healed immediately, but there's also times it's a process. And I've been going through a process, especially these last few years. And God had given me a scripture one morning to let me know exactly what he had called me to do. And it's in 2 Corinthians 1:3-4. And it says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort. And I thought, God, you have been so merciful to me in my life. And you are a God of all comfort. But then he said in verse 4, who comforts, and it says us, but he said Paula, who comforts Paula in all her tribulation, that I may be able, that Paula may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which Paula has been comforted by God. And so he just told me that all I want you to do is comfort others. Comfort those who have lost children. Comfort those who have been through sex trafficking. Comfort those who have been through molestation. Comfort those who have been gang raped. Comfort those who have lived in abuse in their childhood from their parents. Comfort those who have watched their mothers be beat. And I mean, not just beat, but bloody beat. Comfort those who have been beat themselves. Comfort those who have lost a child. It was so hard. I had lost a child in 1982. He was 13 months old of meningitis. And people that came to his funeral, people that came during the week of the way, what they call it, was my ex-husband and my family was Catholic. Then that side of the family was Catholic. And he wanted to have everything done in Catholic. And I didn't know, I didn't understand what it was. But people were coming to us, you know, during the wake, during all that. And one man came up to me and he said, "I don't know how you're still alive. I would have killed myself if that would have happened to one of my children." And I said, "That's why it didn't happen to you. Because I have two other children that rely on me, that need me. I have to take care of them. I can't kill myself." But there was times that I did try to kill myself. There was a time when I was 15 years old that I was down in a pool. And through so many of the things that I had been through, I thought, "Oh, it's so peaceful down here. I just want all the pain inside me to stop. I just want it to quit." And I was pulled out of the pool. I wasn't saved at that time. I wasn't living for God. But he saved me. He had someone pull me out of that pool. And I lived. After my son had died, and it was like 2 years later, not even 2 years later, I had went through the death of my child. I had went through the death of my father. I was 26 years old, 27. I had been through the separation of the man who had beat me for off and on for 13 years. I had been in drugs. I had been drinking a lot. And I tried to commit suicide again. At that time, I wasn't living for God. And my son, 10-year-old son, walked in and found me and called my ex-husband. I had been married again, and he called my husband at the time, and they called the ambulance and they got me to the hospital in time and pumped my stomach, and God saved me again. His mercy was new that morning, that day, again. And through the first marriage, the second marriage, the third marriage, the fourth marriage, I was married 4 months to the most wonderful man I had ever met in my life. He was so amazing. He took such good care of me. But over a period of time, I still wasn't living for the Lord at that time. And all the memories, pictures of the man who molested me were in an album I was looking through of my aunt's. There were things that I was going through of the three marriages before. There was pictures of two other men who had abused me horribly. And my mind was so cluttered with pain. It was so, I was oppressed, I was depressed. You name it, and it was going on through me. And one night I got drunk and I walked in and I took a bottle of pain pills and a bottle of muscle relaxers. My aunt, who lives in Prescott, Arizona, had seen something that I put on Facebook and it concerned her. And so she tried to call and and I didn't answer. And so her husband said, get a well check done on her. Call our local police. They'll get a hold of the police there where she lives. I live in Kansas. And get them out there to do a well check. They came and they found me passed out. The policeman got me out on the porch. And all I remember was sitting there looking up and thinking, what did I do? What did I do? I've fought with fibromyalgia for years. And if anybody knows what chronic pain is, it's a pain that doesn't go away. It's all day long. But your best day is as if you've had the flu and those horrible aches that you get, the body aches, the pain. That's a good day. That's a good day. And, you know, having other situations, you know, going through three knee surgeries on one knee, two on the other. But at that time, I just didn't see anything worth living for. I had three adult children, one step bonus daughter, I call her. I have five grandchildren, but still, an awesome husband, but still, my mind couldn't think farther then stop the pain. I can't handle the pain any longer. I can't do it. And so they got me to the hospital. And on the way to the hospital, I aspirated into my lungs. And they had to put me on a respirator and put me in a sleep coma. I told the doctors that I wasn't probably going to make it through. The doctors told my family, sorry, that I probably wasn't going to make it through. And I remember waking up and looking and seeing the doctor and seeing a nurse and seeing my husband and saying, God, why didn't you let me do it? Why didn't you let me go? And I was mad at God. I was mad. I was furious. And they put me in a hospital and they put me in a mental hospital. And I went through what they called dialectical behavioral courses for a year. I was in the hospital. They wouldn't even let me stay home by myself for over 2 months. A month, 2 months, I can't remember exactly. But that's been 9 years ago. God had mercy on me again. And he brought me home. I have a 12-year-old granddaughter who has been going through leukemia this last year. And a brother who had a horrible mass on his brain. And he came out of it. The doctors told him that he'd probably have to learn how to eat, walk, sleep, talk, probably wouldn't even know anybody. And he woke up knowing everybody and walking and talking and eating on his own. God's mercy. God's mercy is seeing my grandbaby, the 12-year-old girl, getting lumbar punctures, getting spinal taps every month, used to be every week, but getting those every month getting those chemo treatments to where she's so sick. And it's horrible to see. But that little girl, just like last week, she went to get her chemo and get her treatment, had the lumbar puncture, all that, and then turned around and played a volleyball game, helping her team win 6 games. The strength that God has given that child through this, the strength that he has given me to continue every day, your pain. But I learned something these last few weeks even, that we have to go to the cross. It's the cross. We have to know exactly what, you know, the devil believes. We can all believe that Jesus bore our pain. We can believe that he took our sicknesses. We can believe that he took everything. We can believe that he died for us. But do we believe in what he did for us? And that's teaching me to believe in him, having relationship with him, knowing that he is a good, good father, being thankful for every day, every moment of every day, being alive, being able to walk up to someone and say, God loves you. God knows what you're going through. And all those things that I went through, I learned that he was there with me, no matter, it did not matter that I was born again. It didn't matter that I was sinning. He was right there with me. I share about my first husband slicing my hand open with a butcher knife. That was another time God saved my life, because he was after my throat and I threw my hand up and he missed my throat. I wasn't living for God then. I was drunk. My ex-husband was drunk. But God saved my life. So am I thankful? I cannot tell you how much I am thankful for. I'm thankful that my 48-year-old son is walking and alive today. He was shot 28 years ago with a .22 pistol. They didn't know if he was going to make it. They didn't know if he was going to walk. He's walking, and he took over just 2 years ago for my husband's job working out in the oil field as an electrician, as someone who does cement work in it, as once it starts up the oil field. He's out there working hard every day. And not only that, but he's raising his 2 children. I'm thankful for my other son, who God's brought him through 18 years of alcoholism. It's delivered him. I'm thankful for the husband that I've had that's seen me through those days. I'm thankful that God delivered him from alcoholism. I'm thankful that God has let us see each day and grow each day and be able to share with others the comfort that he has comforted us. I'm so thankful. I wake up in the morning and I say, I was reading that book by Benny Hinn. It's called Good Morning, Holy Spirit. And I didn't realize that I was doing that. I was waking up in the morning. For years, I battled depression. A born-again, spirit-filled Christian battling so hard with depression. And I would wake up one day, somebody said that scripture. This is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and I will be glad in it. And so I started before I got up in the morning. I would say, good morning, Father. Good morning, Jesus. Good morning, Holy Spirit. This is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and I will be glad in it. And I was on so the highest antidepressant you can get. And then the Abilify to help work the antidepressant. And all of a sudden, no more antidepressants, no more Abilify. It was gone. The depression was gone. It was like a black cloud just followed me every single day. And that one day, I got up and it was gone. It was gone. Do I still go through things? We still have tests. We still have trials. We still have tribulation. God didn't say that once we're born again and following him and living for him, it's going to be perfect. It's not. But being thankful to him every day, knowing that his mercies are new every morning. Where it says, be anxious for nothing, but with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, make your requests known unto God. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will flood your heart, your soul, your mind, your will, and your emotions. And I'm so thankful that God has showed me that. And I'm finally beginning to live it. After, yes, I was born again, spirit-filled at 28. But at 40, I think it was 44, I walked away. And then 9 years, I came back. But I realized it was working. I was doing works. I was trying to make God love me enough. I just went to a women's retreat conference in Texas 2 weeks ago. And as I'm standing there praising God and singing this song to him, and the words, all I can remember, I can't even remember the song, but I was standing there singing, you are wonderful. You are magnificent. You are glorious. You are glorious. You are glorious. And I audibly heard him say, you are glorious. You are glorious. It's knowing we can love the Lord God with all our hearts, with all our souls, our mind, our will, and our emotions. But we have to know how much God loves us. We have to know that. We've got to get rid of that mindset of I'm no good, that I'm unworthy, that I can't do this, I can't do that for God. We've got to know how much he loves us to be able to get up and comfort others the way he's comforted us. Amen. That's my thankfulness to Did you want me to continue? I was finished there.
Go ahead and share. Yeah, we got an hour.
Okay, I wasn't sure how long. Thank you, Jesus. So I just, you know, God is just so amazing. He's so good. He's so compassionate. He's so merciful. I can't. Today, it's just the thankfulness of his mercy, the thankfulness of his grace. You know, when I was out there partying and drugging and living for the world, you know, and having one man after another, you didn't have to save me. And why did he save me? Like I said, I was mad. I was furious. But he knew that there was something inside me. He knew. The word says it. He knew you before you were even in your mother's womb. He knows the plans and the purpose for our lives. I want to encourage you today that if you have had things happen in your life, it doesn't have to be like mine has been. You could just think that you're not good enough for God to love you so much. You could think that, well, I've been through this or I've been through that. How could God love me? I've been in church all my life, but I still don't feel that love that God has that you're talking about. I want you to know to go to Songs of Solomon and read it. And I'll share just some of that. Because I was sitting out on the porch. The retreat that I went to was, we stayed in cabins. And they were all the old cabins. And it was so amazing because I had, when I lived in Georgia, we were going to, my ex-husband and I were going to redo some cabins. There was three of them on the property. And we were going to redo some of those cabins and for the people going down to the lake. And it was a couple of years ago. I thought, oh, that would be awesome to have those cabins or some cabins or something like that and turn it into a retreat for people to come to. And then I got to go to the to one of those, and she has these cabins, and then her church is on the property. These, I think there's 10 cabins on the properties, and there's you know, she has a food hall and kitchen, and then her place, and people live on there, some, you know, some that live on there to take care of the place. And it's just so amazing how women are taken and they are just loved and cared for. And just, you know, God wants us in his kingdom to find freedom in him, to find out how much he loves us. So the day before, the night before the conference started, I was sitting out on the porch, and I was reading Song of Solomon, and there was big, huge trees, and there was just moss stuff like all over them, and there was hardly any, I mean, it was so dense through these trees and through all this stuff. And all of a sudden, I just seen this beam of light from the sun come down through. It was really cloudy. It was almost, I mean, it was cold. I was sitting out there with a jacket on. And all of a sudden, the sun just shone these glory streaks coming through. And I was like, God, Lord, loves me so much. But in this, I want to read some of chapter 4. And he says, a Song of Solomon, he says, behold, you are fair, my love. Behold, you are fair. You have dove's eyes behind your veil. Your hair is like a flock of goats going down from Mount Gilead. Your teeth are like a flock of shorn sheep, which have come up from the washing, every one of which bears twins. and none is barren among them. Your lips are like a strand of scarlet, and your mouth is lovely. Your temples behind your veil are like a piece of pomegranate. Your neck is like the Tower of David, built for an armory on which hang 1,000 bucklers, all shields of mighty men. Your two breasts are like two fawns, twins of Gezel, which feed among the lilies. Until the day breaks and the shadows flee away, I will go my way to the mountain of mirth and to the hill of frankincense. You are all fair, my love, and there is no spot in you. There is no spot in you. When God sees us, excuse me, when God sees us, when the Father looks at us, he sees our beauty. We see our faults. Oh, my hair is messed up. You know, my hair is not right. Oh, my eyes. Oh, look at this. Oh, I don't have my makeup on right. Oh, my. If only I didn't have this big brown spot on my cheek. Oh, I'm no good. I didn't read my Bible this morning. You know, we put ourselves down so much. But how God sees us is how we need to see ourselves. And it's covered in the blood of Jesus. If this was the blood of Jesus, and this is us, this is how God sees us. He does not see our sins because the blood of Jesus has wiped them away. All he sees is our love. All he sees is our beauty. All he sees is what we are doing for his kingdom. Okay, so here she's saying, I had it last night. And anyway, she's talking about how bad she is, that she's dark and she's, you know, she's not good. And God's telling her, you are beautiful, my beloved. He didn't tell her, yeah, you're not so good. Yeah, you've missed the mark. Yeah, you're just not. You ain't got it. No, he didn't. He said, you are lovely, my beloved. You are lovely, my beloved. We need to start listening to what God says about us. We need to start hearing, you are my beloved. You are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. You are the head and not the tail. You are above and not beneath. You are blessed coming in and going out. You are a child of God. We need to not hear it, just hear it. We need to speak it out of our mouths. We need to take a mirror and put it in front of us. I'm using my phone, but you get the gist. We need to look in the mirror and speak the scriptures that God speaks about us. Those scriptures are personal to us. God doesn't just, you know, used to when I would open this book, I'd open the Bible and I'd be like, I don't know what that means. I mean, I wouldn't even read Revelation, and of course not Song of Solomon. I wouldn't read it. It just was way, way over there. But when we have that, have the Holy Spirit, He opens the eyes of our understanding. He opens the ears, our ears, of understanding. We hear the Father's voice, and the voice of a stranger will not fall. And so we know that we are rescued from the dominion of darkness. We are redeemed from the curse of the law. We are saved by grace, that we are an heir of God and a joint heir with Jesus. We can speak to the mountain and say, "Be thou removed," and it must go. We can ask, believing that we receive when we ask. That we receive. I posted it on Facebook the other day that my husband brought me a dozen roses with some pink stargazing lilies in the middle of it. I went to classes to become a florist 9 years ago. And just because I wanted to do it, and I do it for friends and family. And my husband quit buying me flowers. He used to buy me flowers all the time. There would be times I'd walk in and there'd be two dozen roses there. But he quit. And I'm like, why did you quit doing that? And he says, "Well, you're a florist. You can go get your flowers and you can arrange them. Why need to do that anymore?" It was like, oh. And I asked God, I was like, "You know what? I know I can do that, but I miss my husband bringing me flowers." And I just told him that just a couple of weeks ago and day before yesterday. And he walks with a dozen beautiful red roses and stargazing lilies. And the stargazing lilies were our wedding flowers. I'm so thankful. For God, I'm so thankful, even though neither one of us were living for God, neither one of us. We were so far out there. We met on a biker site. I wasn't looking for somebody. I was talking to a girlfriend of mine in Minnesota. We would sit there talking back and forth, and he sent me a friend request. And he had this awesome, beautiful smile. I was like, "I gotta see that smile." But I was afraid to answer the message. I didn't want to date again anymore. I was tired of men. I was so tired. And I really didn't have time to date. I was working for the railroad, and I worked 3 days during the week and then flipped and worked the whole weekend. I'd work 12-hour shifts on the weekends. So I didn't have time really to date. This man, when I finally started talking to him, we talked for a couple months online and then talked on the phone for weeks. And then we finally met just as friends, just go hang out, something to do. God had plans. God knew plans that he had for me. God knew he had plans for Jesus. And those plans were us together. And I'm so very good. So good. I cannot say how thankful I am. I don't believe there's words enough. And I don't think there's enough words to say how very thankful this woman right here is. I'm thankful that I had the mother and the father, the stepfather, really my bonus father, that really showed me additional love. And I finally know what to do.
And there's several people and listen to you, and they really encouraged. And I praise God that they were encouraged. We only have one prayer request for the final, I think her name is. She's got COVID. And I'm going to tell you, sister, I've had COVID. I think quite a few of us have COVID. You can get through. And that throat, that cough, it still goes with it, don't it?
I had done the home test on
that. That sounds good.
I didn't hear you talking. I took the home test on the COVID test and it came out negative, and then went to the doctor and it came out negative. But the influenza came out positive.
You keep losing the mail. Praise the Lord. He's raised some things. Yes. Go on.
You are.
Yes. But yeah, okay. We got so much to be thankful for. And if we don't thank him through the bad times, how are we going to thank him through the good times? We've got to thank him through the bad times as well as the good times. Yes. Hey, hello, Cindy Travis and Mike Jones. She said something. Got something in the way. Praise the Lord. Okay, let me see. What is that? Okay. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Well, glory to the King. I'm still trying to pull it up so I can see what. I couldn't read all the comments. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you again. Glory to the King. Okay. All right, praise God. Sending these prayers, unspoken, praise God, we're praying for you. Amen, my kindness. I honestly don't feel like that. Are you still with us, Paula?
Yes.
I don't know what he's talking about, but he said don't feel that way. Or she, whatever. And yes, read Ephesians, Mike Joseph. Can you pray for Cindy? She's got an unspoken.
Cindy, glad to pray for Cindy. Yes. Cindy's so precious. She is so amazing. I met Cindy tonight. Years ago, I think. But I just praise you, God. I praise you for Cindy, Father God. I love you so much, Father God. And I know that Cindy loves you. Thank you, Father God. Father, she has a special unspoken request. Father, you know her heart. You know even a teardrop. If we cried, a teardrop fell on a piece of paper, you even know what that teardrop is for, that prayer request, because you know our hearts, you hear our hearts, you know our thoughts, even, Father. So, Father, I ask you that you touch Cindy in the way that she needs to be touched. Cindy, I'm just sending that. The Lord wants you to know that he wants you to know how much he does love you. And there is he's no respecter of persons. And he loves you and he cares for you. just as much as he does for me, just as much as he does for Deborah or anyone else. And all you have to do is ask him, and it will be done. Your request will be done. It's sometimes I've heard it and I know now. Sometimes the answer is not no, it's just delay. It's just delay. So don't give up. Mary, don't give up. Because it's 11:59. It's not 12.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hello, Sister Fuki.
Fuki, God bless you.
And oh, my sister Bella Harrison got some personal business matters that I need prayer for. You know, as she was praying for Cindy, I was hearing what she was telling Cindy about don't give up. So that's what I'm hearing for you, Bella. Don't give up. Just keep praying. And the time may not be right now, is what I'm hearing. Thank you, Jesus. But we're going to agree with you that whatever the person, business matter, that it will come to pass in Jesus' name. And Cindy said, yes, in Jesus' name. But yeah, it's something you said, business matters that you need prayer for. But, you know, yeah, you definitely have to pray over everything that you do nowadays, because if you're encountering some business propositions, it may be that the Lord is saying, wait, don't step in. Because just because one door opens and it looks so good, we'll give you this, we'll do this. But once you step in that door, it may not be what you thought it was. So be careful. Lord, thank you, Jesus. That was not from Debbie. That was from the Holy Spirit.
Yes, Lord.
I'm promising. Because I wasn't even thinking about that. And he just put it in my spirit. Let you know. Every door to opportunity is not a good door to opportunity. Father God, let her help her. Help her decide the right, make the right choice on this matter. Whatever this is, all I know is what you're telling me. In Jesus' my name.
Give it to him.
Just say no. Amen.
Give that business to him. You know, it says, seek ye first the kingdom, God and all his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And I believe there's times, you know, I've tried to start a couple of businesses, a couple of things going on. You know, I sell this, sell that. Mm-hmm. And it's like, what's going on? They're not working. But sometimes I think I wasn't putting God first. I wasn't seeking him.
Yeah.
And asking him what
sometimes he'll say, well, did you ask me or is saying our live video is interrupted, but now I think it can say anything though. But this has been very powerful. And like I said, we've been talking about Thanksgiving. Thank God for where you're at right now. Thank him for what he's done for you so far. Thank you, Jesus. You said, my video has. And we are under freeze warning. Hope it's, but my laptop's still working. Praise the Lord.
Yeah, it's cut out a couple of times.
Yeah, I think it has too. So, and if we do completely cut off, it's because of our weather that's going on around here. If you have nothing else to share, I'm usually on only an hour on HOD because they always have a broadcast right after each other. So if you don't mind, close us out in a word of prayer.
Father, I just thank you. I just praise you. We give you glory. We give you honor, Father God, today. We thank you, Father God, because this is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and we will be glad in it, Father God. We thank you, Father God, for the words you brought today. We thank you, Father God, for what you brought us through, what you are taking us to. And Father God, knowing that you have our lives in your ways, that we trust you, Father God. We trust you, knowing that you have every step of our life planned out, Father. And we just need to yield to you and receive it. Father, thank you for this platform. Thank you, Father God, for Deborah. Thank you, Father God, for the people that have watched. I just honor Deborah, Father God. I thank you for her, Father God. And I thank you, Father God, for healing her from the top of her head to the bottom of her toes, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. And like I tell y'all, I love each and every one of y'all. Thank y'all for joining. But Jesus loves you a lot more than I do. Praise
God. Amen.
And as far as I know, I am doing Bible study this Saturday at 2 o'clock because I thought I was not going to be able to do it, but I can do it this Saturday. But next Saturday, I will not have Bible study. So y'all meet me in the Zoom room at 2 o'clock. We're in the Book of Romans. God bless y'all. Love y'all. Turn this off.